Check this out. This is a 2014 Marathon coach. It's built on Prevost X3 chassis. Now, there's one thing that separates this coach from every other motorhome that's on the road today, and it's simply, well, it's mine. Yes, I just purchased this Marathon coach, and as you know, I already have a 1957 flexible Starliner. While that coach is absolutely fantastic, it's great for short trips, a night or two. I was really looking, in fact, I've been looking for well over a year, closer to a year and a half, to get a full-size motorhome that I can travel with around the country, that has modern convenience and something that's reliable. And I ended up with this. Now, during my shopping, as you know, if you're shopping for a motorhome, it is confusing. When I got down, I just got tired of looking. I brought in a consultant. As I was narrowing my search down, I already knew the floor plans and what features and functions on the inside or the house would work for me. I needed somebody that would help me understand the different systems, and you're going to meet him in just a moment. So what we're going to do, we're going to do a walk around of the coach. Just look at the individual bays and hopefully try to get an explanation of which switches to flip and which buttons to push under specific situations. And all that starts right now on the Gadget Guru. Okay, let me introduce you to this guy. This is Gil Johnson, and let me tell you how I met him. Gil is an admin at the Prevost Owners Group. Now, that place is a wealth of information of everything Prevost. Now, Gil, how long have you been associated with that site?
Oh, it must be about 5 years at this point.
And what do you do for them? I mean, it seems that you and another gentleman, Dale, are really active and or proactive in answering user questions.
Yeah, we moderate. We try to stimulate conversation. And when somebody has an issue, we try to find them an answer or rely on the membership to help one another. The one thing that we kind of pride ourselves in is kind help for those that need it.
Well, I got to tell you, it's very friendly, and I got to tell you, it's very newbie friendly. And when I was at the Prevost show in Tampa in January, you know, you look around, I'm seeing 50 some odd coaches there, and you know, they, when you're there, you're looking at the inside, you're looking at floor plans. There's so much that someone like me just doesn't know the difference between one and another. In fact, I was hoping that when I'm going around, it'd be nice if every coach had a rule that said, okay, you have to put the year and the price on here, because you can take a 10-year-old Prevost and a 2-year-old Prevost, and it's difficult for rookie to tell the difference between one and another. But the reason I bring up that show, while I was there, and I'm talking to a lot of people, your name came up consistently, that you're an extremely knowledgeable person about various builds, brands, converters, and ages of Prevost. How did you get involved in the Prevost world?
Well, being an owner, that's what put you in there. And being a person that did some offshore boating, we kind of want to make sure we understand how these things work. So anytime I've got something, I make it a point to fully understand well beyond what most owners are going to want or need to make sure I understand how these things work.
Is it just obvious to say that the systems on a motor coach and a boat are similar? I mean,
there's a lot of similarities between the yachting world and the high-end RVs. And rightfully so, because almost everything that occurs here happens on a yacht. And the yachts, when we look globally, they obviously have far greater numbers than they do in the motor coach world. So it didn't make much sense for the motor coach world to go off on their own. They did that for a while, but they finally have all kind of converged. Even look at Marathon, the number one producer of coaches, and they're up to some numbers just shy of 1,300 coaches. 1,300 coaches may sound like a lot, and it certainly is, but not compared to the global environment of yachting.
Yeah, that, or you say 1,300 coaches. I don't know what Marathon's production is per year. I'm guessing somewhere between 20 and 30. Honestly, I've just never asked. But you look at that in the big picture, the Class A industry. And as readers and viewers know, I've spent a lot of time comparing. You know, do I go with a top-tier Class A or do I go with the pre-owned Prevost? You know, on paper, the Class A's look really good. And what got me over to Marathon was, you know, I wanted something that I could get serviced fairly easily, with not a lot of hassle, and Marathon seems, at this point, let's hope it stays this way, to be a very good fit for me. But now, let me tell you how this happened. While I was at the Prevost Stuff Show, just people that I was meeting. We're talking about, you know, who are the knowledgeable, independent people in Prevost. And your name came up consistently that you're just a straight shooter. Did you know your stuff? And I got to tell you, over the past few days, I absolutely agree. Now, what had happened? I've been looking for, it's probably a year and a half, and I keep going back and forth of various brands. And again, you'll see all that on the website. And, you know, one day I got frustrated with looking, and I tried this, you know, previously, and it just didn't work about 6 months ago. Through the Prevost Owners Group site, you know, I noticed when I had questions, they were answered very friendly. And I just contacted you, said, do you ever do consultant work? I've kind of narrowed it down to about four coaches or so. Is there a way you can help me evaluate more than floor plan of what's going on? And you said yes. Now, I have to ask you, is this something unusual? Am I the first time you've done that for somebody?
Well, I tend to provide help wherever I can. This is the first time I've actually went out and assisted somebody in the acquisition or decision process in the coach. Now, I've helped people with deliveries and training on them, but this is the first time I've taken somebody from, I think I want a coach and I think this is what I'm looking for, to helping them in that decision process as to which coach is the right coach, which one, you know, which converter has the right systems for you, which one are you going to feel the most comfortable with. So, yeah, you're the first.
There is a fee involved. However, and I'm not going to go into fees because every situation is different. You know, I'm fortunate. You don't live that far from Marathon.
Correct.
So that helped keep the expenses reasonable. But, you know, with that said, I think it's money well spent because here's what's happened. While we're at Marathon, of course, they're giving me orientations. They're doing, you know, inspections. It is very comforting to have your own independent inspector. And I would, you know, they say in the Class A world, that's pretty typical. You want a coach inspect, especially if it's pre-owned. If it's new, you're going to have warranty. You know, this, you know, we're buying it, I won't say as is. They're bringing, you know, everything up. We, all the, pretty much zeroing it out between the seller and myself. There's new tires, there's new batteries. But to have somebody like Gil overseeing it, to make sure that we're making smart decisions is a good thing. Now, if people want to contact you, if they want this type of service, and don't worry, we're going to walk around the coach a minute. We're going to show you some things. What's the best way to get a hold of you?
Well, I'm certainly going to be on that Prevost Owners Group forum.
Okay.
So that's the easiest way to find me.
Now, if that's a paid site, can people who aren't members, and I believe you charge $100 a year, can they contact you through that site if they're not a member?
I'm not sure if we have that access open, but, you know, certainly they can look at things. But otherwise, you know, they can call me, they can send me an email. So,
okay.
You know, I come from the yachting world, so I've kind of kept my email address, which is strawlergill1l@gmail.com.
It's okay if we put that down the screen.
Sure.
And again, don't call them to check what the weather's like in
right.
South Florida or West
mm-hmm.
Florida. But if you do, again, your site has a lot of good resources, and I just had to tell you firsthand that while, you know, Marathon's doing the work, and you'll see as we walk around, there's still some, you know, work in doing the finalized PDI and some things that, you know, while we've stayed here that we've seen come up. While they're doing it, to have an independent like Gil to explain things to me in a plain English manner is invaluable. Now, we spent a lot of time doing this. Let's walk around. Let's go in and go over to the first bay here. Now, this is going to be typical, and I'd say most of the Prevost I've seen. This is a storage bay, is that correct?
Yeah, in almost all cases, the first bay is your bay. Mm-hmm. Now, there will be some cases where this has been used, but generally speaking, in any conversion, your bay is the first bay. And they do that for a few reasons. Maybe one of them is just because it's convenient to the door, but frankly, that's not it. These are complex machines that have a lot going on. And a lot rides right here on the front axle. So what we try to do, what the converters try to do, is make sure that those things that aren't terribly heavy, which is almost always your stuff, resides here closest to the front axle.
Okay, now, even if I load this up with all the luggage it can be, you're not going to overload the front axle. Is that a fair assessment?
Well, so one of the most critical things when you own one of these coaches, they're heavy. They're 50-some thousand pounds. Mm. This is your most critical factor right up here. And you want to make sure you understand what your coach weighs as it is equipped for your normal operation.
Okay.
To make sure that you're adjusting your pressures right and that you haven't exceeded this. In some cases, maybe more than not, you can put too much on here.
Now, last night you and I took the coach through the scales, the CAT scales over at Flying J down the street. What did you see on those numbers? Granted, we're just using the default tire pressures right now that came from Prevost on new Michelin tires. Was there anything that was alarming? Now, we're semi-loaded. We're not fully loaded, but we did have full tank of water on here.
Yeah, so I saw what I kind of expected is, you know, we're kind of sitting at the edge of where we should be on the high side for the front axle. But if you get the opportunity, CAT scales are great. They weigh the axles, but what they don't weigh is the difference from the left to the right side on each axle. And I got to tell you, most converters do a really good job of left to right balance. But you want to know what that is, and this is more so in the Class A world than it is in our conversion world. But if you got one side that will say weighs 500 pounds than the other, then you got to make sure that you've raised your pressure for the highest.
And you do that by compensating more or less air pressure in your tires to compensate for the weight that's being used.
Right.
Now, while we had that done, and I hope this is going to work out, and if so, we might have a video on. I'm having a service come by to do corner weights. If that works out, how important is that to do?
Once your coach is loaded, you do that once and you're good forever. Unless, you know, something dramatically changes in your life. So if you're a beach goer and this is a bunch of, you know, stuff to take to the beach, some umbrellas, some chairs, and then tomorrow you become a lead acid battery sales guy and you want to keep all your inventory up here, then you've got a significant change. Mm-hmm. But generally speaking, you weigh it once, you know what your weight should be, you know what your pressure should be, you're good.
Okay, now if that works out, you'll see a card pop up on this YouTube video, and that'll give you a link to that. I can't tell you right now because we haven't gotten there yet. Now there's, of course, you have the ladder down here, but there was something unusual in this bay. Should we show it to them?
Yeah, so each converter has those things that they do that are kind of unique to them. And this is a really nice feature. And it's I don't know that it's...
There, pull this up here.
And I'm not sure it's a feature that you'll find in anything other than a Marathon. But this table that they put in years ago, I think they actually discontinued it for just a short while and then put it back in. That is far better than any portable table that you're going to put out. And when we get to the next bay, you'll see this actually links into the whole outdoor cooking environment. So this is a workstation for cooking. Put that away in the evening. You know, wine, cheese, whatever it is. This is just a great feature that self-stores, doesn't take much space.
And you know what's good about this, and again, we don't have this bay open. We're going bay to bay here. There's four chairs in here that, you know, have the Marathon logo on here that fit right down here. But when you get to the next bay, there's some additional features. I tell you, I saw this. Is this the thing that makes you want to go out and buy a coach? No. But is it a good feature? Absolutely. Because it's one less thing you have to stow. Okay, now to get this back in, I'm just going to pull that point up here.
Pull it out.
Then I have to pull it out. See, I'm learning as I go along. Put that back in, and then it locks. And I have to tell you, the quality of the little mechanisms on each one are pretty good. Now, let's go in and close this, and then we'll go over to the next bay.
Mm-hmm.
And the next bay, it might surprise some people, so come on down here. This is probably, and again, is this a decision-making bay? Well, when you see inside, this is something I would have liked to have had. And when I saw it, I'm happy with it. Still learning how to get the doors open in one nice pull. Now, check this out. Gil, why don't you do the honors, and I'll go in and pull her out. And by the way, this is on an automatic slide. What would you call this? A pneumatic slide, or what?
It does have an air-operated slide.
You can probably hear the air through my microphone here. Okay. Now, as we discussed before, if you can point to the chairs over there, we have four chairs. I don't think we need to pull them out.
Yeah, and that, you're going to find that on every converter. They've got a set of Zip D chairs, nice, comfortable. But what's really unique here is that we got an outdoor environment for cooking. So a lot of people like to spend a lot of time outside. In this particular case, you got electric cooktop, and some of them, not this one, but in some of them, this can actually be moved as well. And then obviously places to store things, and for those that need a cool beverage, You got to have a place to keep things cool as
well. And what's interesting, there's a lock on this. I was thinking, okay, if you're tailgating, keep people from stealing your beverages. But you were telling me there's a practical usage why to have a lock on this.
Yeah, and these coaches, they don't move much going down the road. They ride real, real well. But if you got a bunch of drinks that are stacked up in there, you know, they may tend to vibrate over and hit this door and open it up just a little bit. It'll be up against the back of this, so nothing's going to come out. But you will be surprised when you open this door and you've stopped, because that door will continue to open. And whatever those drinks are hopefully in plastic containers, because they're going to hit the ground.
And we have a key. We have it hidden, so that way people don't come and steal my beverages. I'm just kidding. Okay, now let's talk about this grill and let's start getting the usage. Now, again, this grill still needs to be cleaned. But, you know, again, they're still undergoing the final corrections on the PDI. This is an electric grill. Okay, you and I talked about it. Under what situations, whether I'm at a campground or dry camping or whatever, can I use this, safely use this grill without tripping breakers?
Well, certainly anything that's a cooktop's a high current device. So you're going to be using this if you're plugged into your campground's power, or if you're a football field or wherever doing some tailgating, you're going to run the generator to do this. Don't expect to run a cooking top, whether here or inside, or a clothes dryer for that matter, off of your inverter power. There is a lot of inverter power, power that's supplied to AC components through the DC battery banks, but it's not enough and shouldn't be used for these high loads like this cooktop.
Okay, so people who are new to motorhoming, the Prevost world, or any motorhome, let's go in and do some basic one-on-ones here, because I'm learning as we go. Okay, the operation that's going to give you the highest amount of power to run just about everything you want to run, that's the generator, is that correct?
It is, and that varies from converter to converter as well. And converters do things differently about shedding load. And shedding load's all about when I don't have my maximum power. In this case, on a marathon coach, we got 80 amps if we're on the generator. We could do anything we want. We have
no
restrictions.
So I could run all four air conditioners.
Everything.
I can run the toe kick heaters. I can have the TV on inside. You know, I guess we could be doing washer and dryer and barbecue. Could we do all that, or do we? What would we have to eliminate, or how would this automatically shed or get rid of the loads?
Well, the good thing in the marathon world is they don't want the customer to have to think about what they have to do or not do.
Now you know one reason why I came to this break, because that's an important factor.
So if we're running on generator, you can realistically run everything. There may be some chances that, you know, it doesn't work because you got all four air conditioners cycling at the same time, which they can't do because they have staggered timers. But generally, you can run everything if you're on that.
Okay.
Now, if you're on 50 amp shore power and you try to do that, you could have problems. But with a marathon, anytime you exceed 50 amps, they're going to start shutting things off, and you'll get a light in the back that tells you that that occurred.
Is that throwing breakers, or is it just kind of automatic where it, I know I will see warnings, and one day we'll do an inside video of what's inside the. Okay, so let's say I am on shore power and I kick on one appliance too many. You say shed loads. Give me some detail. What does that mean, and how does it do it? Then what do I do to fix it?
Yeah, so again, this will be unique, you know, converter to converter, but in the case of Marathon, they take everything that's an ancillary load that's nice to have, but if you're using too much power, you would rightfully want to get rid of. All of those devices, those whatever they are, go away when you exceed 50 amps. So that would be like the cooktop, that would be the clothes dryer, that would be this. So all of those would go away, and that not only is it important that they do it automatically and that you don't have to think about it, but let's just say for sake of argument, you're at the campsite, you just got there, you turn on all your air conditioners, which they're going to run, they may be running a lot to get the coach initially cooled down, and maybe you want to put the dryer on and then you want to step away for a while. Well, the last thing you want to do is come back and find out that your coach is dead, the batteries are down because you didn't have the generator auto start set, because it took manual intervention to do that load shedding or getting rid of those excess loads. So automatic is good from a multitude of reasons, but primarily, and the reason that converters like Marathon do that, is to make sure you don't have to think about it.
Okay, now, just in practical applications. I'm tailgating. I'm at a football game. Two air conditioners on inside. Let's say we have, in this one, that's a whole nother conversation, but let's say I have both the salon and the galley. The front section cooled after the other door, so we're nice and cool for tailgating. You know, that is if you live in South Florida like I do and you're going to a football game and it's hot outside. We have that going. We come out and turn on the barbecue grill. We have TVs running. No problem whatsoever.
None whatsoever.
If we even add washer, dryer, somebody spills something, we're cleaning something. If we add that to the equation, no problem.
No problem.
Okay. Okay, so that's it on here. And the other thing again, and by the way, you know, there's also room behind here. Like, for example, here's one of those folding aluminum tables. I know I'm not going to put it together, but there's space behind here. I guess there's about 18 inches in depth. And full of almost the full width of the cabinet and the height here. So it does give you additional storage. I know behind here, there's some things to get in there, it takes some crawling. Are those things I'm typically ever going to have to get to? Those are some kind of inverter or something.
Yeah, what most of the converters will do is hide things that they don't want you to touch. Not because you can't, but because there's no value in doing so.
Okay.
So, you know, if you're an engineer and you're buying one of these things, you want to understand how all the little things behind the covers work. And you could take your time and look behind there, but even to try to protect the general customer, most of the converters, they limit the amount of information that they even provide to you because they don't want you getting into there. Not because it's going to hurt anything, but in the case of a coach, any of the newer coaches, they have so much automation that you can get into the automation systems and start messing with things that affect more than you might think, and then, you know, you have to get their tech support to help you out.
Is it fair to say at this time, I really don't, I mean, we went through them, you know, yesterday, if it ain't broken, don't fix it, right?
That's right.
Okay, let's go in and pull this in. You have enough room where you get your hand in here without anything getting hurt. And then we'll go to the next bay, which is probably gonna be very familiar. By the way, there's a latch on the side here. I keep having to remember to do it, and Gil was kind enough to do that. Let's go on and walk over here to the next bay, and then we'll open this one up. And this bay might look familiar, because you see this in a lot of the, or I guess all price ranges of motorhome. The entertainment center. Now, I don't know if this is a 40, 45 inch, but it's a TV, and what this has, it's going in, it has a tilt. So if you think about it, if you remember back, we had the barbecue grill. We had the table. You also had a fold-out table, you know, which was an option or a personal item here. This is really set up where you could be grilling, dining, entertaining. And of course, we don't have the awnings out right now. I mean, I guess we should. I was just afraid that when we're shooting video that the light might not look that good. But we come back here. You have, this is a Parasound soundbar. You have a subwoofer behind it. And up here, you have your switch lights. You have your patio lights. This way you can control the patio lights for both indoors and outdoors over here. The switch lights just make that illuminate. Again, these are the switches here that are used to open and close, or to angle the device. Gil, what do we have below here? Let's start on this side over here.
Yeah, generally anything that's behind these doors, you have no reason to get behind. So in this particular coach, we're going to find a lot of controls that support either the water, the freshwater system, or our black and gray water system. So we'll find water pumps in here. We'll find water filters for the coach itself, for the ice maker, for the InstaHot. So generally, there's nothing back here that you would get to. This is a service area. You get back here if there's a problem.
Okay. And then when we open up this one here, is this more of the same?
It's more of the same.
Is an important one here. We were talking about this yesterday. And I think I can sum it up over here. Over here, you have a black tank drain. Over here, you have a, I don't know if you can see it, but a gray tank drain. You have a reversing valve. Now, here's what was very cool about this. Unlike my 1957 flexible Starliner, where everything's manual, on the other side, when you hook up and you hit the black or gray dump, this is electric. Or I don't know, it's electric or pneumatic.
In this case, it's electric.
It's automatic. And then what it does, it pulls out. Now, you gave me a good tip, and this is good for anybody to know. Should something happen, should these things fail, you just pop out the carter pin, and then you can manually open and close your dumps. Now, make sure you're connected when you do that. And I guess most Prevost converters, they do something similar to this.
Yeah, they'll have some that are air, they'll have some that are electric, and there's still many that are just physical, you know, manual valves.
Okay.
Now, and it's probably important to note that we're looking on this side of the coach, so for those that don't know Marathon, the drains are still on the other side where they rightfully belong, but the valves are on this side, so the hose goes from here to the other side for draining.
Okay. So, all we know, we've tried that and it works.
Right.
And I tell you, it was, you know, a lot of people who might be a little freaked out about dumping the tanks if they saw the Robin Williams movie RV. Let me tell you, It's not that difficult. You just go through a procedure. It's 1, 2, 3. Again, on my Starliner, it's much different because I have to do separate connections, both for the black and the gray. This takes about 1/3 the time, and again, it's much, much faster. Okay, let's go in and close this. And again, the switch, just need to make sure you don't push it. This is on an electric motor, it sounds like.
Right.
Get it all the way in, and then we'll go in and close this one. Again, Gil's been kind enough to hit the latch over there. And now the first thing you notice here, this is not a handle. This is a press to open button. What's that for? Or why do you think they do that?
Well, they do that because most of the coaches actually have over the road air in here. It would never need to be open. And frankly, there's little that you need to go into this bay for as well. But let's take a look and see what's behind the cover.
Okay, we open it up. Oops, let me add it. There we go. This swings open. Now I look in here. Here's how I know that the house batteries are in here. There's a label that says house batteries. I know we have some disconnect chips. Why don't you take a minute and just give us an overview about when I'm going to need to touch anything in here.
Well, the only time you're really ever going to get in here is if you're going to store the coach for a prolonged period of time.
Okay, so let's say in the real world, I have a storage warehouse that I use for this amount of the bus. So I put in, let's say I'm not going to use the bus for 3 weeks that I know of. I'm plugged into 50 amp shore power undercover storage. How would I use this?
Well, if you're plugged into power, that's enough to keep the batteries charged. Then there's really no reason to get here in here at all. But if you didn't have power, then this is actually where you control the DC power for the engine, the chassis side of this.
So
and all those, these are chassis switches. As you pointed out, this is the house batteries.
Okay.
So this compartment is also, this is a Volvo powered newer coach. So this is actually where they put the Volvo computer and the Allison computer back in this bay as well.
Okay. So let's say I have the same scenario, but I'm parked outside or I don't have shore power, whatever it is. Is there a rule of thumb of how long I should let it go? I guess if I'm indoors, I don't want to use my auto gen start because that
right.
could be dangerous. And I guess I'm trying not to answer my own question here, but if I don't have shore power, what is the rule of thumb of how long, if I know I'm going to be away, that I should use these disconnects?
That's really a hard one to answer because with each model year and each that Prevost supplied, some of them have so little draw that you could go months with those still on. And as they started putting in the multiplex systems to manage the Prevost side of this chassis and slides and slide computers, in some cases that load might be greater. So the safe thing is if you're going to put it away in storage and you don't have power, rather than figure out whether I should turn those off if I'm going to be here a week or a month, just turn them off. So there's no fear in turning them off. So I would suggest that if it's stored, it doesn't have any power to charge the batteries, that just turn them off.
Okay. So basically, whether it's going to be a week or a month,
right.
If I'm not connected to shore power, just come in. And to flip them off, I go from on to off. Is there any preparation inside I need? I mean, this is only chassis.
Right.
So basically, as long as the engine's off and everything else, I'm good.
Right.
Okay. Let's go on and move over to the next, or before we get to the next section, right here. Okay. Now, this is a point. Now, I'm talking about a lot of things that got me to Marathon. This is a point of confusion, but a lot of this, it's not necessarily Marathon, it's Prevost. Remember, this is the 2014. On both sides of the coach, we have a diesel, you know, filler,
right.
I guess, well, I don't know what you call it. This is where I put the diesel fuel. Now, below here is a DEF tank, correct? Now, if I'm going into a fuel pump, typically it's going to be on the driver's, not the passenger side,
correct.
For diesel. So what is the smart thing I need to do of refilling the DEF fluid? Because if I remember, it's...
The diesel exhaust fluid?
Yeah, it holds 16 gallons in this tank and approximately 200 gallons of diesel. How often do I have to use it? And then how do I do that when I go into a fuel station?
Well, there's multitude of ways of doing the fill on the DEF, but you're right, the commercial truck stops, the DEF fill is always on the other side.
And because of our height, we're going to be using a lot of commercial truck stops, is that correct?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
So what you can do, there's two things you could approach. One of them is you should always have a couple gallon tank, fuel tank, that you could put in here, and you're going to keep DEF in it. Or you stop at that truck stop and you'll fill your portable tank and walk around and dump it in here. So you're in the truck stop, you fill your portable tank from the DEF pump that's on the other side, walk around and stick it in.
Okay, when you're at again, this is new to me on this, because my old bus only takes, it has fuel. I have two tanks, generator and engine, they're separate.
Right.
Okay, while I'm filling it in for diesel, can DEF be pumped simultaneously?
No.
Okay, so you turn one off, do you have to complete the transaction, then start all over again, or can it be done on the same?
Yeah, depending on the station, you don't have to go in. You know, they want, these are commercial truck stops, they don't want to waste a lot of time out there. So a lot of them allow you to pump the DEF and then pump the fuel all at the same time. Not at all the same time, but without having to go in and end the transaction.
Okay, now as you've gotten to me, I try to think things through and try to come up with the easy solutions. It's my easy solution. You know, of course, when I start off with fuel, full tanks on both. When I stop to refill diesel, if it's convenient, go on and top this tank off.
Right.
And then before it gets critical, or when I get to about 50% or 40 or 30%, then I need to find ways to fill it up, whether it's filling up an auxiliary tank or just going to Walmart or wherever and buying the DEFs and just putting them in, right? Is that just the best way to do it? Use the service stations when it's convenient, and when it's not, just make sure I have extra.
Yeah, you should always carry some with you, but it's probably always going to be convenient at a truck stop. I don't know that you can find a truck stop that doesn't have DEF anymore.
Well, all I know is that, like last night, we went to truck stop at Scales. There's long lines there.
Correct.
And you really don't want to stop for an extra 10 minutes and anger the person behind you. I'm just trying to think of the courteous way to do this.
Well, the courteous way to do it is when you get there and you need DEF, the first thing you do is you fill your container with DEF, and then you start the diesel fuel, and while that's filling your coach, you come over onto the other side and you fill your DEF while the diesel's running.
Okay, so while we're doing that, is it wise to leave your diesel fuel running? I mean, is it reliable in auto stopping? Is it going to foam over? Do you need to sit there and monitor? Granted, you have a second person that solves that issue, but if you don't.
You shouldn't leave the pump unattended, but the fact of the matter is, you're probably putting quite a bit of diesel fuel in. You've got plenty of time to come over here and put the DEF in. Even with the diesel high-speed pumps, you've got plenty of time to fill this and get back before it's
off. I guess the other thing I'd do, if I am filling up the cans, pull away from the pump when you get finished. Put them in there. Let the next guy in. Is that good common courtesy? We're not going to go there. Okay. One other question. I know on many Class A's, in newer models, they're putting both the diesel and the DEF filler on both sides. Is Prevost doing that in their newer models yet?
Yes.
Okay.
And that was actually driven by one of the converters. The converter actually came up with the method to do it, and Prevost looked at it and actually adopted it.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So that's good to know. So this is the 2014. It's new to me, and let me tell you, this thing's in good shape. Okay, let's move down here, because I know a lot of people are going to be afraid to ask questions, but I'm not going to be. You have your drive and your tag. Which is which?
Well, drive, and in this particular case, and in most of them, we're going to have two tires here, and then tag.
Okay.
Now, so this one's carrying the weight, and that one's just providing a little bit of support.
Okay. Now tell me, what is the purpose of having this?
Well, the purpose of having a tag axle is, frankly, because there's a lot of weight back here, and you can't put it all here.
Okay. Now, this is a lifting tag. There's a switch right up there on the dash or on the panel on the left. You hit it. Does it actually lift it, or what happens when you lift the
tag? As heavy as these coaches are, the tag wheels seldom come off the ground, but they're not carrying any weight, but they're still sitting on the ground.
And the reason
that you're going to raise that tag is because you're in a parking lot, you're going to make a real sharp turn like you might be backing into a campsite, and you just don't want to scuff that tire, and it does reduce your turning radius a little bit.
So basically what that does, instead of having your pivot point somewhere kind of in between when both are down and scrubbing, it moves your pivot point to right here.
Correct.
Now the other question is, this is an X3, and one of the big changes to the X3 was this. How did that change everything from the XL2 was the previous generation?
Yeah, so in XL2s there were two chassis. Mm-hmm. There was one for the motorhome industry and there was one for the entertainers.
Okay.
And when they went to the X3, they only supply one shell. Okay. Everybody gets the same one, which means fundamentally that your axles now are in the entertainer position, which is further back, longer wheelbase, better ride on the highway.
Okay. Now, what that means to, if you're not an entertainer, you're just a consumer, a user, I guess what that means is that your tail swim is going to be less, because how far did they move back the drive in tag?
I don't have the number on top of my head, but it's roughly, call it 20 inches.
Okay, so basically 20 inches is quite a bit when you get to the geometry, because if you look at here, you know, your tail swing is only going to be just a few feet out here.
Right.
Okay, now we're going to start getting to the working part of the bus. And I tell you what we're going to do. This video's run very long, so we're going to go in and take that into part two. You know, questions, comments, opinions, post them right below. And remember, the easiest way to keep posted to my new videos is just to like us on Facebook at facebook.com/thegadgetguru. Don't forget to subscribe to us right here on YouTube. We're going to come back with part two, putting a link for it right down here. Thanks for joining us. I'm the Gadget Guru, Andy Parr.